Don't you get shy on me, lift up your song. Cause you've got a line inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Oh, come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me, lift up your song. Cause you've got a line inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me, lift up your song. Cause you've got a line inside of those lungs. Get up.
Back to FBC. Let's stand together as we open up in prayer this evening and prepare to worship the Lord together. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for allowing us to be here tonight. God, we thank you for a wonderful day, God, of church this morning and a great afternoon. And just thank you for giving us the privilege to come into your house and worship you, Lord. And tonight we lift your name on high and we just praise you, God, for who you are and for all that you've done. We pray that you be here with us in Christ's name. Amen.
Thank you. we sing Yes I Will. Oh,
can be seated. First normal Sunday night we've had in a little while. It's been a busy stretch, different things going on, and holidays and Brazil trips and everything else. It's kind of nice to be back into a somewhat normal routine. Tonight we're going to be talking about the first part of the book of Ezra, where we were this morning. Specifically this morning we're in chapter 3. We're going to read that again. It's a really... Again, one of those pivotal moments in the biblical narrative where the people go back to their homeland after 70 years of exile and discipline. And so it's, again, a historic moment for the nation, for them to return to their homeland. But even more than going back to their home was the beginning of the reconstruction of the temple and getting back to that true worship of God, where God wanted to be worshipped by His people, the way that He wanted to be worshipped in the first place. We talked about going back to the basics this morning. We'll go through that and dig a little bit deeper. Let's read the word together, though, in Ezra chapter 3, just to remind us. We'll go through the whole thing. It says, when the seventh month arrived and the Israelites were in their towns, the people gathered as one in Jerusalem. And so for 7 months, basically, they go to their hometown, right? And they're probably getting some things in order at home, and then they come together as one people in the holy city of Jerusalem. It says that Jeshua, son of Jozadak, and his brothers, the priests, along with Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, and his brothers began to build the altar of Israel's God in order to offer burnt offerings on it, as it was written in the law of Moses, the man of God. They set up the altar on its foundation and offered burnt offerings for the morning and evening on it to the Lord, even though they feared the surrounding peoples. They celebrated the festival of shelters as prescribed and offered burnt offerings each day based on the number specified by ordinance for each festival day. Now, let me just touch on this real quick. The feast of festival of shelters or of booths or tabernacles, it's the one where they go out. Remember in The Chosen, we see them building the little hut. And they lived in that, and we talked about that a little bit, of what that looked like in that day. That's what this is right here. All right, verse 5 says, after that, they offered the regular burnt offering and the offerings for the beginning of each month and for all the Lord's appointed holy occasions, as well as the freewill offerings brought to the Lord. On the first day of the seventh month, they began to offer burnt offerings to the Lord, even though the foundation of the Lord's temple had not yet been laid. They gave money to the stonecutters and artisans and gave food, drink, and oil to the people of Sidon and Tyre. So they would bring cedar wood from Lebanon to Joppa by sea, according to the authorization given them by King Cyrus of Persia. In the second month of the second year after they arrived at God's house in Jerusalem, Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, Jeshua, son of Jozadak, and the rest of their brothers, including the priests, the Levites, and all who had returned to Jerusalem from captivity, began to build. They appointed the Levites, who were 20 years old or more, to supervise the work on the Lord's house. Jeshua, or Joshua, with his sons and brothers, Kadmiel with his sons, and the sons of Judah and of Henadad, with their sons and brothers. A little bit of a tongue twister here. The Levites joined together to supervise those working on the house of God. When the builders had laid the foundation of the Lord's temple, the priests, dressed in their robes and holding trumpets, and the Levites descended from Asaph, holding cymbals, took their positions to praise the Lord as King David of Israel had instructed. And I just began to picture this scene. Finally, after all this time, they've got their holy garments back on. They're standing there with the instruments, getting ready to worship God. Verse 11 says, they sang with praise and thanksgiving to the Lord, for He is good. His faithful love to Israel endures forever. I wonder who wrote those words. Sounds something like King David would write, right? Then all the people gave a great shout of praise to the Lord, because the foundation of the Lord's house had been laid. But many of the older priests, Levites, and family heads who had seen the first temple wept loudly when they saw the foundation of this temple. But many others shouted joyfully. The people could not distinguish the sound of the joyful shouting from that of the weeping, because the people were shouting so loudly, and the sound was heard far away. I just, thinking about Israel and being there, I wonder how far away, for those of you that have been in Jerusalem, how far away they actually heard the sound of this people. You're thinking tens of thousands of people shouting, and either shouts of joy or weeping. They weep very loudly, kind of the same way they shout joyfully. So you can begin to imagine. All right, this morning we boiled it down to these 4 points. One is, sometimes we have to go back in order to go forward. Two, great progress requires great sacrifice from everyone. It's a united front. Great progress requires great flexibility from everyone. And lastly, we must balance past experiences with future expectations. And that one can be a little bit tricky. All right, we've got our microphones coming around. What did you take away this morning?
My takeaway would be that on occasion, all of us needs to go back to Bethel, renew, and begin again.
Yeah. Sometimes you just need to have that moment in the sand, right? And just, all right, let's get back to the basics. You'll have a fresh start, a recommitment, rededication, whatever you want to call it. Get back to the very basics, those foundational things. Start fresh. Doc?
The need for flexibility to obtain progress.
Yeah. And that is so easy in the church, right? I mean, it's so easy to be flexible and say, hey, this needs done. Let's figure out a way to do it. No, that's normally not how business goes. But it does. It requires some flexibility and then looking at things. We'll talk a little bit more about that. But yeah, it's tough sometimes. Anybody else?
I think that last point really resonated with me, is that, you know, you need to learn from what happened and kind of think about the past, but you don't need to live there.
Yeah.
You know, you have to move on and learn from it and try not to make that same mistake again.
Yeah. And that's tough. And you think about, one, in your own life, the necessity to, one, learn from your past, successes and failures, and look towards the future. But also think about that as a church or as a group of people. The same thing's true. And in most groups, the church included, you'll have some people that have some experience behind them, and they can help kind of guide you through some things. But at the same time, we get in these ruts, right? And sometimes we get these blinders on, and we don't always see some of the possibilities. And so that's why it's also important to have some fresh ideas come in. And so you got to balance the two. Anybody else?
The first point is sometimes you have to go backwards before you go forward. And I don't know, this morning when you, before the message, and you said to me that, or you said to hear that our government corrected a huge mistake. It was made 50 years ago. Hmm. And, you know, there's nearly 70 million mistakes have been made since then. To do that, I think that was a perfect lead to the message.
Yeah.
Because we just, in my opinion, we just corrected that to, in order to move forward. It's had us moving backwards for a long time. So I just thought it was so, the timing was right.
Amen. Yeah, I agree. I think, you know, we've been praying about even our nation moving forward, right, and getting on a good, godly track. And for, like you said, for the past 50 years, we've had this hanging over our head that we've, spiritually speaking, it's been holding us back.
Pastor, if I may take a liberty to balance between you and I can do this with you because I'm older than you. So my takeaway, going back to the basics, just with what was in January of 1973, 50 years back, I was born before that and lived through that 50 years. As long as you have lived, you've never known anything else.
That's true. That's true.
There's the balance between reaching back and flexibility with the elders that were weeping. Remember that they're not weeping because that they regret a new temple.
Right.
They remember the glory days, the elaborate temple. But they were rejoicing, too, that here's a new beginning.
Yeah.
So I think there's a balance that we need the whole church.
Exactly. Exactly. Good example. Okay. Well, let's dig into this just a little bit deeper. The first thing we talked about was the need to sometimes go back in order to go forward. And again, we're not talking about going back to your past and just dwelling on that. There's a time to go back and revisit some of those decisions and some of those circumstances or even things that happened to you in order to process that. But dwelling on it and just living there is totally unhealthy, and that's not what you want to do. But sometimes you do need to go back to the very basic things, especially in your spiritual life, that help shape you, that help form you, that help lay that foundation. I think the foundation of the temple is a great illustration of this, that help lay the foundation for your own spiritual walk, and maybe over time they've become routine, or maybe you've neglected them, or whatever the case may be. And I think that's one of the great detriments to our faith on a daily basis as Christians is getting into a place with the spiritual disciplines, things like worship and prayer and Bible study and all of this, to where it just becomes so routine that you just find yourself going through the motions and you're not really growing or getting anything out of it. And so we're doing everything right, but your heart's just not in it. And that's a tough place to be. So next question, this is my cue to hit the button. When have you found yourself just going through the motions? And then the follow-up to that is, how did you combat that? Now everybody in the room has been there. So it's okay to talk about it.
Well, seeing as how that I taught Mr. Tony, I believe I can put a little age on several of you. Whenever you're rearing your family and they're all going in different directions. You know, you're just doing all you can just to get them up and get them ready and get everybody. And unfortunately, the Lord sometimes takes the backside.
Amen.
And it's difficult, especially when you're working and raising a family and shuffling it all together.
Yeah.
And that doesn't make it right, but it sometimes happens. Yeah. And I think it did in our life.
Sure. I appreciate that, Mrs. Tysel. That's exactly what I'm talking about with some of that wisdom saying, hey, you young people that's trying to raise a family, this is when it gets tough. And I agree. I think that's probably one of the biggest times in life that this gets difficult because you are so focused on getting the kids up, getting them ready, getting to work, getting dinner taken care of. Now, in today's, it's running the kids to all these different activities they're involved in, right, and sports and extracurricular things. And by the way, if Sunday rolls around and we're so wore out from the week, we don't want to get up and go to church. And I have to get up at 4:30 just to get myself ready and the kids ready and husband or wife out the door, and I don't have time or I don't take time to read God's word in the morning like I used to. It gets tough. And so I think a lot of us can relate to that.
Yeah, I just was thinking, to me, it's, you know, you get busy and you compromise and say, well, I'll do it tonight and stuff, and then, you know, it just kind of goes like that. And then to me, the way to combat it is, okay, no, I know it works best when I get up, I set the time aside, I get up early, I get in the Word, then I have my prayer time, then I go on with my day and get that consistency back. And to me, that's how I've always been able to combat it. It's just a, okay, I got to go back and do it.
Just buckle down and do it. Yep. Good. Mary?
The first thing I think of in just going through the motions is after I lost my parents, and I was going through the motions. I was going to church. I was attempting to read my Bible and pray and stuff. But the way I combated it was to let friends know to be praying for me.
Oh, yeah. Good. Let's invite some other people into this battle and join me in prayer, right? Very good. Very good. Anybody else? Oh, yeah.
Like I think you purposely just, and you may not want to, you go find somebody who you can serve, and that works. I think that starts to take you out of it a little bit.
Good.
You do the things you should do, like Tom said.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think it's a great example. Here he said, sometimes I just need to go and serve somebody else. And I totally agree with that, because as we've talked about before, that takes some of your focus off yourself, right, and onto someone else and away from your problems and your things that has to get done. And, yeah, I think that's a great one. You know, several years, it's been a long time, you know, maybe 10, 15 years ago, I remember, and I don't know if they still do this, but K-Love used to encourage people to do a 30-day K-Love challenge where you don't listen to anything else on your radio except for K-Love. So basically, you listen to praise music every time you get in the car for 30 days. And there was a time in my life, even as a Christian, that challenge really helped me. It really pulled me out of maybe a little bit of a slump I was in. And you think it's something so simple, but you think about it, when you're listening to, I won't name names, something other than Christian music, I think it takes a toll on you, whether you realize it or not. And then you begin to listen to nothing but stuff that's God-honoring and glorifying. It kind of changes your thoughts, your attitude, and your heart even. Okay, there you go. All right. So again, we mentioned a lot of things. I think it could be just some examples I thought of, going back to those fundamentals. As we approach the end of the year, for a lot of folks, it may mean, you know, making a commitment. Hey, I'm going to read through God's Word this year, kind of like what we encourage folks to do this year. Taking that reading plan out, or setting aside, like Doc said, that time every day. I know I'm going to get up 10 minutes early tomorrow because I need that 10 minutes to spend time with the Lord. Read and pray and reflect a little bit. Or for some people, it's simply getting back into that routine of going to church. You know, after the summer months are over, prayerfully, we'll probably see some people start rolling back in that's been gone for the past couple months, right? And so that's just little things like that. So once that foundation is laid or relayed, then it's time to start moving forward. And I think, again, the book of Ezra really gives us a beautiful illustration of that. They lay the foundation stone for the temple, and then they began to press forward with the rebuilding. Now, they run into some snags. We'll talk about that later. But at this point, Ezra tells us that the people had basically united and resolved as one people to get this done, to rebuild this temple in Jerusalem. And then we see how this work and this building and really just this progress in general requires great sacrifice from everybody involved, right? It took a lot to build such an incredible building. I can't even imagine doing it today. But it took a lot of materials, a lot of resources, and because of that, a lot of sacrifice. But they were able to get it done. How have you seen people give sacrificially to make something possible?
Well, I wasn't here during that time, but that's what I was going to say, is the Family Life Center.
Yeah. Family. I think our Family Life Center is a great example of people giving above and beyond, giving sacrificially to make something possible.
Yeah, I mean, that's what they did was, you know, they challenged everybody to say, okay, for the next 3 years, you're going to give so much per month so that we can get this thing paid down.
Yeah.
And we had a three-year commitment, basically, the folk, and we signed a paper how much we were going to give and stuff like that. And so, yeah, it was neat to watch the church come together with that.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And for a great purpose, too. I mean, I was this week, as I that thought came to my mind, and I began to think about all the things that it's been used for and just the number of kids that's come through there and all that stuff. Monica?
Well, I was thinking about us that went to Brazil, the guy that lived up above the church. He had helped to build a roof over the church the week before we got there. He had broke both arms, and one of them, Doc can explain it, but it was he had pins sticking out of his arm, two big, if you saw, he had two, things to hold his arm.
Yeah, cast, and he was all tied up, looked like he was in a straitjacket, and he'd come every day, he'd be down at the church like this, trying to just be there. It was awesome.
And he was so good to us the whole time. He came down there every day and tried to help and do everything he could. But he definitely sacrificed a lot. Yeah,
absolutely.
We don't know if his arms are going to be back right or not.
Yeah, I don't know. Yep. Anybody else? It really is. It's a beautiful thing when this happens, when you see this, and you see God place a vision in front of a group of people and them rally together and say, all right, let's lace up our boots and make this happen. And then give towards that. When you read through, those first couple chapters of Ezra talks about just how much the people gave to the construction of the temple, at least at this point in time. And I mentioned some of that. I said there were 61,000 gold coins, 3 tons of silver. And I did a little math this afternoon just to kind of put that in perspective based on today's values. And they gave 18,300 ounces of gold. That's what that coin equates, 18,300 ounces of gold. That, you know how much that's worth in today's money? About $33.4 million worth of gold. And then they gave 3 tons of silver, which 3 tons of silver comes up to about a little over $2 million worth of silver. So these people, this ragtag bunch of people that had been drugged back home from Babylon, gave $35 million worth of stuff to rebuild God's temple. Can you even imagine? I mean, it's incredible, really. Well, let's talk about this. There's another side to this. What makes sacrificial giving difficult for people today? Because I'm not so sure that the older generations, I think they may have done a better job than the younger when it comes to this.
I think some of it comes back to you're looking at a generation of people that weren't all of us raised in church.
Yeah.
So they don't really know the meaning of sacrificial giving. And then at the same time, it's not something that you have to do. It's a sacrifice.
Yeah.
And sometimes sacrifices hurt. So they cost you something. And sometimes people don't want to give that up.
Absolutely. I agree.
Debt.
I was thinking along those lines too. You know, the folks, the man and woman, my great aunt and uncle that kind of raised me for the youngest part of my life, they were never in debt for anything, I don't think. They bought their house that they live in today 100 years ago. They paid like $12,000 for it back then. They've never went in debt for a vehicle. They never went in debt for anything that I know of. Maybe land. I don't even know if they went in debt for that. But they didn't live paycheck to paycheck. You know, they knew how to save and put back, and they knew how to be frugal. And now, man, if you cut off one person's paycheck for, the next pay period, they're hurting. It's literally paycheck to paycheck, and there's nothing to, we don't know how to manage money, really. And we got all the debt on top of that, And like Kristen said, there's a whole bunch of us that weren't raised in church that don't even know what giving sacrificially or worshipfully is supposed to look like.
Yeah, it was just, unfortunately, our society has got past that. I mean, I didn't even know this, but Luke was telling me I was blessed to be able to spend a week with Bruce and Luke and all their kids this last week. And he was saying now they have car loans for 12 years now. You can get up to 12 years on the loan.
Unreal.
I mean, and so people are so strapped financially wise that they go, you know, somebody's going to come pull something from their house or their car or take their car if they give sacrificially.
Yeah.
Because they don't have any margin. And that was one of the things that when I was growing up, we were, you know, not growing up, but in getting in medicine and stuff, was they were saying, you know, you've got to give yourself some margin so that you can have the time to worship God, so that you can have the time to do a discipleship group, so you can have the time to be at an extra event at the church. Yeah. I mean, because if our lives, if we schedule, have everything to schedule, we're not giving God any time to eat. You know, it's, you're talking about sacrificial giving, but it's in your time too.
Absolutely.
And kind of protecting it a little bit so that you have some margin so you can do that.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Anybody else? Jimmy?
I think most younger people are selfish.
Yeah.
They don't want to share that with the Lord.
I agree. I think there's a mentality that's very pervasive. It says, this is mine. I've earned this. It belongs to me. I'll do whatever I want to with it. And I'm not going to share it with anybody. I've earned it by whatever way, and it's mine. All right. Well, the people in Ezra, they weren't like that. They were rallied around this God-ordained purpose that the Lord had put placed before them. And not only did they give sacrificially of their time and their treasure, but they were very flexible, as we saw in the way they went about this and their approach. And we talked about a little bit about that significance right here in Leviticus. Ezra 3, going back to that Levitical requirement, that age requirement of originally 30 years old, dropped down to 25, and then now they drop it again to 20 years old for somebody to be a Levitical priest and serve in the Lord's house. And so they were willing to do that, I think, out of necessity. They needed that to happen in order to get things done. So when have you had to be flexible in your thinking or in your approach to something?
We had a new beatitude as teachers when I first started teaching. Blessed are the flexible, for they'll never be bent out of shape. So I learned it early on in my career when last minute changes to the schedule or random pep rally showed up or whatever, just to chill out.
Yeah. I can tell you what, 15 people learned some great flexibility last week. Monica?
I think after you become a parent, you learn it's over. You don't get to really, I mean, you can try to plan everything, but it's just so many things happen when you have children.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. So the mission team that went to Brazil, those 15 people, one thing that some of us knew, and I think some of us had to learn, is when you're on the mission field, in a foreign country, basically working for that church or that pastor, you got to be very flexible because they may not do things the way that we do things. And for example, most days our counterparts they're not very punctual like we are. So we may say we need, you know, all right, let's agree we're going to be picked up at 8:30 from the hotel in the morning. Well, 9 o'clock may roll around and we're getting on the bus, you know, to head to the church. And you just got to roll with it, right? Sometimes there was one night we were expecting some dinner, and things got lost in translation, and we ended up not eating probably about, I don't know, 9:30, 10 o'clock at night. And we were getting a little frustrated, a little tired, and a little hungry, but you just got to be flexible because, again, you're not there to teach them a lesson about punctuality. You're there to show them the love of the Lord. And I think we're getting close on that night, but anyway, yeah, you got to be flexible.
That was a little iffy.
It was, yeah. You got to be flexible. Now, Monica mentioned when kids come along, and I agree that you got to, as a parent, you got to be flexible in a lot of things. I'm learning now as the person in the middle, as the parent with the kids, and now I've got grandparents to deal with. Well, boy, you better be flexible with some grandparents, because now, I'm glad she's not here. The grandparents don't do things, they don't operate the same way that they operated 30 years ago when I was a kid. Now, you can't plan anything with them. I mean, they're just all over the place, and they're going to do what they want to do, and they're going to do with the kids whatever they want to do, and there's nothing that I can do about it, right? So you just got to be a little more flexible. You're right. You're right, Leonard. Number one. So some other things to consider, you know, maybe there's some cultural changes that take place across society, which means that we or the church has to go about things a little differently. There could be some things that we once did that were very effective, but now they're no longer effective or efficient, so you got to make some adjustments. Maybe things that once worked just don't work, so we got to find a better way or just kind of write it off. Whatever the case, forward progress almost always requires us to be flexible in some way. Now, why is flexibility, when we say flexibility, we kind of mean a new or a different approach, hard for some of us to accept? Why is it? It is. I'm not going to argue that it's not tough, but why is it so tough sometimes? We just don't like change. I mean, that's really what it boils down to, right? Anybody else?
Here is more. What we're forced to be flexible on is not good for us as Christians or a nation or in anything. So anytime I hear anybody wanting the flexibility, back of my hair goes up on the back of my neck.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a great point, Nathan. Some of the things that we're asked, and I'll use this word, to compromise on, aren't things we need to be flexible with, right? And so I think you're right. Sometimes anybody starts talking about something new or different, man, let's hold up a minute. What exactly are you talking about here? And more importantly, why? Why do we need to make this adjustment? Sometimes it's not always good. You know, there's something about having done things a certain way and got the result that you want out of it for so long that makes it tough to see anybody do it any way different. So I'll give you another example. We're working with the grandparents, when it comes to gardening. You know, they've been raising the garden for longer than I've been alive, putting things up. And so the other night I was putting away some tomatoes, me and Caitlin, and we were putting up some tomatoes and stuff. And my mom was there, and bless her heart, she's trying to tell me how I needed to do this. Not like I hadn't done this before, but it wasn't the same way that she did. She didn't, and she realized what she was doing, and finally she said, "Could you care if I tell you how I do this step right here?" I'll go right ahead. Go right ahead, you know. And the same thing my aunt does to her when she goes to her house and they're putting up beets or tomatoes or whatever, and she's standing right over, although mom's probably done it 100 times herself, right? It's got to be done this way because that's the way that I've always done it. And we run into this all the time, and I always go back to the old saying that there's more than one way to skin a cat, right? And so you got to be a little bit flexible for some things. Not all things. All right. We talked about, lastly, balancing those past experiences with those future expectations. And again, both of those are very important. And I think everybody would agree with that. You know, we kind of talked about it a little bit tonight, how we got to learn from our past, but we also got to keep an eye on where the Lord wants to take us next. And I'm sure, you know, things like a big building project, like the Family Life Center, there was probably some debate, I'm sure, that went on about, you know, why do we need this? What is this going to look like when we do build it? What are we going to do with it? What policies are going to guide it? All this kind of stuff. Why are we spending this amount of money to get this? And why aren't we putting more money into this part of it? And you know, it's just the way it goes. So you got people that have done stuff like this before. Then you got people that's got ideas on stuff they've never done. And somewhere you got to meet in the middle, right? So when have you been able to learn from a past experience?
You know, this is really funny because you're pretty much giving me a lecture from my business class that I'm taking right now. And this was what my reading was about today.
Good.
I had to do a discussion post on something I had learned from a negative experience in my work situation. So I had this employee. She'd just been giving me a hard time for weeks and weeks and weeks. Very bad attitude, poor language, just something you don't need to have at work. And very rebellious against things that I wanted her to do. So I had to write about this today. And I had to examine myself in it and how I reacted to her. And I reacted very poorly to her. You know, she told me that I needed to respect her because she was my elder, to which I responded, "You're going to respect me because I'm your supervisor." but what I learned was that with her anger, I should have counteracted that with being calm and collected. And instead, I let myself, my anger, get the best of me.
Yeah.
So I got to learn that today.
Okay. So maybe next time when somebody else's temper lay up here, you can...
Yeah, my temper ain't going to go there.
Not get back into that.
She pushed the wrong button.
Good. Good example. Good example. Anybody else? Hopefully we have learned as we go through life. That would be wisdom. Doc?
You know, what I was just thinking, all the mission trips I've been on, which is kind of a few, you know, each one puts me in kind of a different situation and a different tough spot or whatever, but I can go back to those and say, okay, God was faithful here, God was faithful here, God was faithful here, God was faithful here, God was very faithful in that way, you know, and I'm saying, okay, we're doing this for you, God, you're going to make it work out, and I just need to, you know, just stay calm and it all work out, you know. I mean, just like this week, you know, this past week, I was frustrated with our volume because I said, man, is this going to work out? You know, and I knew we were where we needed to be, but it just wasn't clicking.
Yeah.
And then those last 2 days, it really just exploded, and, you know, God did what he needed to do, and we just needed to keep our mouths shut.
Good. So in Ezra, we see, even though the people are united, and I like the language that Ezra uses, is they gathered as one in Jerusalem. And I think that's beautiful. It's awesome they were able to do that. But at the same time, even though they were focused on the same goal and they had the same agenda, there's a little bit of tension between the past and the future, right? And we see the ones that had seen the first temple, they're having a completely different emotional experience than the ones who hadn't. And as they laid this foundational stone, that fortunately they were able to still come together, both sides, and uniting around this common desire to do whatever it is that God wants us to do, which in this case was to rebuild this temple. So how can we, How can we balance past experiences with future hopes in order to accomplish whatever it is that God wants us to do? How do you do that? How do you do that as a church?
We have to realize that things have to change. We have to accept that. And we can't just look back and think it has to be exactly done exactly how we, when we were younger. And it, we just have to accept that there's going to be changes, and it's what God wants. And our church isn't going to grow. And we're not going to lead as many people to God if we don't, you know, move forward.
Yeah. Okay.
I'll just say something real quick. We have to use it to move forward, whatever it is, whatever the experience is. We have to use it to move forward. If it was a negative experience,
yeah,
we have to learn from that.
Yeah.
Right? If it's a positive experience, we have to remember that.
Yeah.
And so each one of those experiences helps us move forward.
Good. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Brittany? I think our skills that balance the two things are love and obedience. We have to love each other. Even if we disagree, we have to sit down and speak with love instead of anger and try to see one another's viewpoints or learn from those experiences. But also, obedience is better than sacrifice. Mm. So if God's saying to do something a certain way, then we do it. Yeah. But we do it with love.
Okay.
To kind of tie together what Miss Wilmore called me out. In her class, and me being who I am, and she acted as if it was the only course that was being taught, and she was the only teacher that I had to report to and be obedient to. And so me being who I am, I voiced my opinion, and this was her retort, and I still remember very vividly what she said. As far as I'm concerned, this is the only class you've got, Tommy, period.
Sometimes, what Mark is saying too, is that sometimes those were positive things that maybe we left and we need to circle back to.
Yeah.
Some things worked really well, and then for whatever reason, we needed to change. But sometimes it's good to look at past experiences and go, what worked? Will it work now? If it won't, fine. But if it will, maybe we need to go back.
Yeah, absolutely. Very good point. And I'll give you an example from our church history. And this is one reason I love that we have such a thorough church history and people that have worked hard to preserve that. One thing that our church did very well for the first 150 years, I guess, was plant other churches. A lot of the churches in our community came out of this church. A lot of them, and there's a long list of them. You'd be surprised, some of them out in the county that came out of this church right here. Now, that's one good thing that we've gotten away from in our church history that, you know, maybe worth thinking about. Now, granted, there may not be a need for another church like our church right down the road, right? There's a lot now. But what's one thing that our denomination has been promoting that's similar to church planting? Revitalization is one, and there's a second piece of that coin, replanting. So it may be time to go back and either put our arm around some of these plants that maybe they're suffering, right? And as the mother church, go back and say, well, let's partner with you for the revitalization process, help you get back to where you need to be. Or maybe we need to help replant this church that we planted 60, 70, 100 years ago, and it's not done so well for the last little bit. And, you know, that's just one example. Anybody else? Balancing past experiences with future hopes, or future expectations. I'll tell you one way I think our church does this well, as far as a multi-generational approach to things, is, yeah, we're a committee-driven church, right? Our committees do a lot of work and a lot of ministry. And if you look at a lot of our committees or our ministry teams, it's a pretty good variety. You've got some folks with some experience and some wisdom on those, paired up with some newer, younger blood with some fresh ideas, and they come together and they make a lot of really good things happen. Because some folks say, hey, we tried this, it didn't really work, but maybe if we took part of what you're suggesting and pair it with this, it may be phenomenal. And I think we're starting to see a lot of that. Anybody else? How do you do that as an individual? How do you balance between your past, where you've been, things you've learned, and where you want to go without being so caught up in your past and so caught up in the future that you miss the present day-to-day right before you?
I'll say one thing that Shane had preached on this morning is always mentoring someone to fill your position, and that's one thing that he's very passionate about, is investing in somebody that kind of in the same ways that he was invested in.
Yeah.
And so that's one thing that he really tries to kind of like push forward, is you always need to be mentoring somebody, and you always need to be mentored by someone.
Absolutely.
So I think, you know, just thinking about that, you know, how to accomplish what God wants, that's really the goal. You know, we're supposed to spread the gospel, and we're supposed to teach God's love, and if you are not mentoring someone, and if you are not being invested in by a mentor, there needs to be some evaluation made. So
yeah, good. Sounds a lot like discipleship. Yeah. Good. All right, let's stop there, and let's spend some time in prayer this evening. Let's share some prayer requests if you've got.